left them jams. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. It's my life, it's better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance.
Get through one night without you. If I had to live without you, what kind of life would that be? Oh, now I need you in my arms, need you to hold. You're my world, my heart, my soul. If you ever leave, baby, you would take away everything good in my life. Ooh, without you, there'd be no sun in the sky. There would be no love in my life. There'd be no world left for me. And I, baby, I don't know what I would do. I'd be lost if I lost you. If you ever leave, baby, you would take away everything real in my life. I want to know, how do I breathe without you? If you ever go, how do I ever, ever survive? How do I
I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small. And you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Of the angels around the throne tonight. Spend
all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Oh, memories seep from my veins. Let me be empty. Oh, I'm weightless, and maybe I'll find some peace tonight in the arms of the angel. You are probably some comfort here. So tired of the straight line, and everywhere you turn, there's vultures and thieves at your back. Storm keeps on twisting, keep on building the lies that you make up for all that you lack. It don't make no difference. Escape one last time. It's easier to believe in this sweet madness, all this glorious sadness that brings me to my knees in the arms of the angel. Fly away from here, from this dark, cold hotel and the endlessness that you feel. You are pulled from the wreckage of your silent reverie. In the arms of the angel, may you find some comfort here.
Go to heaven on the shadow. Nearly 40 years ago, I did the funeral for your baby. I can still remember George carrying that little tiny casket from the coach to the graveside. I can still see that. At that service, I brought a message, just a little brief message at the graveside. And it's still appropriate today. Just let me give you the story. David's son, him and Bathsheba, had a baby. The baby was sick unto death. David was in mourning, sackcloth, ashes, and comes down in verse 18. He heard the servants whispering. It said, and it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And up until then, they were in mourning. And the child was sick and it died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself if we tell him the child is dead? But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, yep, he's dead. Then David arose from the earth, washed, anointed himself, changed his apparel, and came into the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he came to his own house, and when he required, they ate bread. Set bread before him, and he did eat. And then said his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst weep for the child while it was alive, but when the child was dead, thou didst rise and eat bread. And he said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept, for I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me that the child may live? Here's the verse I want to leave with you. But now he is dead. Wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? No. He said, I shall go to him, but he shall not return unto me. The reason I read that first, because we're here to celebrate the life of George. And in a little while, I'm going to give a short message that I got from Judy, by the way. I'm going to give a short message. Susie's going to read some stuff. I'm going to sing. We're going to go to the cemetery for a very short service and military honors. Then we're going to have a reception at the VFW. Some people sometimes question that. They say, wow, aren't we supposed to be in mourning? No, we're in celebration of his life. And George is more alive today than he's ever been. He's healthier today than he's ever been. And you know what? I believe George is cheering in heaven because he doesn't have to wear a mask today. I said, you know what? That's a good thing. So we're here to celebrate his life. Yeah, he's gone, leaves a big hole, especially in Diana's life. But we're going to celebrate his life. And I want to leave you with some verses today that might help you get through the day and the weeks to come. Father, thank you for allowing me to be here and have a part in this service. I pray that the scriptures that are read, the things that are said, the music that's sung, will all be to the honor and glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we ask your blessing upon this service, the cemetery, and the reception to follow, and our day of celebration. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I think the last time I did something like this was for Crystal. It's not any easier right now. George David Abney was born February 22, 1940, in Denver, Colorado, to Marie and Vant Abney. George graduated from Sheridan High School in Denver and at age 23 was drafted to serve in the United States Army in the Vietnam War. His rank as a specialist was given for his acumen with M16s during his service from 1963 to 1965. George worked for Hobart Equipment in both Denver and Wichita as one of their top technicians for 25 years. He then pursued a natural calling of towing and servicing vehicles for AAA until 2013. George was a gifted mechanic and had a love and appreciation of working on vehicles old and new, a trait that he passed on to his grandsons. On June 25th, 1976, he married Diana Prophet in Denver, and they recently celebrated 44 years of marriage. George is survived by his wife, Diana, daughter, Melissa, brother, Jack, sister, Fran, grandchildren, Jamie, Andy, Emily, Abby, and Caleb, 7 great-grandchildren, and numerous nieces and nephews. He is preceded in death by his parents, his children, Matthew and Crystal, and siblings, Ray, Sharon, and Ella. I first met George when I was 9. He was my first crush and new brother-in-law. He was the coolest, most handsomest man I'd ever known. He had a boat, a motorcycle, an old truck, a big dog, a ranchero, and a mustache. As I grew up, I realized just how cool he truly was. For whatever George lacked in physical stature, he made up for in character. I never heard him speak a harsh word to anyone, except maybe once when us kids back in the day took our silliness too far at the dinner table. He was a quiet man of strength, work ethic, and a fierce love for his family. It's said that integrity is the way one conducts themselves when no one is watching. And George was the embodiment of integrity. He was a good man in every sense of that phrase, and everyone that knew him or met him along the way also knew it. George traded the temper of his younger days for a certain grit, a stubborn determination to keep going at a steady pace, no matter how tough or painful things got. He never complained and he never quit. He just kept going, being George, for the sake of his family. He was a man of few words, and a keen observer. But when he did, it was always with relevance and sharp insight. He greeted strangers and acquaintances alike with a genuine friendliness that you don't see a lot of today. Whether it was a frazzled driver with car problems or family or friends he hadn't seen for a while, he always made you feel better than you were before. Our family is so much better off having him in it, and he will be forever cherished and missed. In my mind's eye, I see him now tinkering on some old Chevy with his brother Ray and David. Crystal is most likely handing them tools and chattering his ear off. But whatever he's doing up there, I can hear his laughter. I know that the sparkle in his eye is finally back.
Well, soon we'll come to the end of life's journey, and perhaps we'll never meet anymore. Till we gather in heaven's bright city, far away on that beautiful shore. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we struggle through this world and its strife, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the charming roses bloom forever, and where separations come no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore. They say that we will meet by the river. No storm clouds ever darken the sky, and they say we'll be happy forever in that wonderful sweet by and by. If we never meet again this side of heaven, as we travel through this world and strive, there's another meeting place somewhere in heaven, by the side of the river of life, where the charming roses bloom forever, and where separations come no more. If we never meet again this side of heaven, I will meet you on that beautiful shore. I will meet you. Oh, I will meet you on that beautiful shore. River
attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross. And I'll bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight, and the clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The Lord shall descend, and the trumpet shall sound. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Well, you can say that if you're a born-again Christian today. It's well with my soul. 43 years ago, George was saved, and I baptized him. Somebody asked me from the funeral home a while ago, asked me, how do you know this family? How do I not know this family? Years and years ago, I moved from Texas to Colorado to start the Cherry Creek Baptist Church. There was a pastor across town, Reverend Al Lacey. He quit pastoring and went into full-time evangelism. He and Joanne joined my church. Along with them, they brought several families. Of those families was Jim and Sylvia Prophet. Jim was one of my deacons. Sylvia ran my nursery. And she was certainly qualified because they took foster kids in. I remember Russell. Oh my goodness. There's a There's a dog called a Russell Terrier. Russell was the human side of the Russell Terrier. I mean, but Sylvie didn't let him get by with absolutely anything. One thing that Jim and Sylvia taught their kids, their family, and practiced was loyalty, first of all, to the Lord, and then to the preacher. Everybody in this family calls me preacher. Just out of respect. Not because I'm any better than anybody else, but out of respect. And so Jim and Sylvia raised these kids. And over the years, I've had way too many funerals for this family. Jim and Sylvia, your baby, Crystal, now George, Steve, David. I think I told Judy the other day, I said, we need to start having weddings. I had one, Josh. That was the last time I saw George out at Jackson Lake in Colorado. But you know what? The Bible is full of stories. They were born, they lived, and they died. None of us are going to get out of here alive. We're either going to go when the trumpet sounds, as that song talked about, or one of these days, I'm going to have to live to be 150 to outlive most of you, but one of these days, if the Lord doesn't come, you're going to be having a service for me. I'll have Reverend Susie Prophet bring that message. Thanks for your help, Suze. I'll bet. Yeah, it'll be a good thing I'll be gone, because so the other day when George went into the hospital and then hospice, and Judy and I were having a conversation on the phone, and we commiserated with talking about family and different occasions. And Judy brought up this verse. Last Sunday, every Sunday morning, I miss two Sundays, but every Sunday morning I do a video, and somebody puts it up on Facebook, and I sing a song, and then I bring a, Diane and Judy said, why don't you bring a short message with those songs? And they emphasized short. Not that short, but 6 or 7 minutes, that's pretty good for me. So anyway, last Sunday, I sang that song, If We Never Meet Again, This Side of Heaven. And I used these verses out of Hebrews chapter 12 and verses 1 and 2. It says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. I'm going to tell you today, you're in serious trouble if you're looking unto Wall Street for direction. You're in real serious trouble if you're looking to the District of Columbia for your guidance. We need to get our eyes off of whatever they're calling it this week, Corona, COVID, Noble, flu, whatever. We need to get our eyes off of that and get our eyes back on Jesus, who's the author and finisher of our faith. And so I leave you with a message today. If you ever want to see George again, he's in heaven. He's kicking up gold dust. I'll bet if George had his way, he'd have hired a backhoe to dig a deep hole, and he'd have sat in that tow truck and got buried in that tow truck instead of this fancy casket. It's going to lead us to the cemetery. Oh, by the way, I think that's just pretty cool. But George is happy today. And George, last week, joined this great cloud of witnesses to watch how we run the race that is set before us. And Judy and I had this conversation. I wonder how much they can see. Well, that's sometimes scary. And I don't have the answer. All I know is that Jim and Sylvia and Steve and David and Crystal and the baby and George and all of them make up this great cloud of witnesses. And I'm going to tell you something. I don't know how much and what they can see, but I know they can see how you and you and you and I run the race that is set before us. So I want to leave some verses with you today over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verses 6 through 8. Paul said, we are confident, therefore we are always confident knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. We're absent from the Lord. George is with the Lord. He says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. In chapter 7 and verse 1, he says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. I want you to understand that the other day when George took his last breath, that quick, he was in the presence of the Lord. There is no soul sleep. This is the house that he lived in while he was here. I told the person yesterday, we came by here and for a little while last night, I said, and I believe this with all my heart, and Susie alluded to this, George was the most gentle, kind person I believe I ever met. And I'm sure he had his moments. No, he didn't have his moments. He was just gentle. He was kind. He was a hard worker. He was a loyal servant of Almighty God. Was he perfect? No, but none of us are. Paul said, as long as we're on this earth, we're absent from the Lord. And he says, that great cloud of witnesses, he says, we need to lay aside two things. The weight that doth beset us, and the sin that is ever before us. The weight. That weight can be any number of things. That weight today is sorrow. That weight in life can be worry. That weight can be bitterness. It'll eat you alive. We need to, as those left behind, lay aside the weight that is ever, and the sin that is ever before us. Back over in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. See, Judy, what a message you gave me the other day just talking on the phone. Thank you very much. 1 Corinthians 9, 24. Says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all? When Paul wrote this, he was familiar with the Parthenon and the Olympics in Rome. And he said, we need to lay aside those weights, take them off. And he says, we which run in a race run all, but one receives the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly. So fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Here it is. Here's how we run the race. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Over in Philippians, let me go back to Psalm. There's so much in the Bible, and I promise we'll be done by 1 o'clock here today. But there's so much in the Bible on daily living. And what I want to leave with you today is, how are you going to live your daily life knowing that George is in that great cloud of witnesses? Something to think about. And understand, the Bible says, James says in the book of James, he says, true religion and undefiled is this, to take care of the fatherless and the widows. That before God is your obligation today. That's our obligation. Boy, it just feels funny to call you a widow. You know, I saw a picture up there of Janine and I and you and George standing in front of our house in Westminster, and you and I both had darker hair at that time. So it feels odd to call Diane a widow, but she is. For whatever reason, God took her life's partner home, left her here, and I'm telling you, it's your obligation. Kids, grandkids, friends, it's your obligation. It's my obligation to take care of the fatherless and the widows. If she needs anything, it's up to you to take care of that. If she needs support, if she needs she knows she can call me anytime. In fact, the other day, she wanted me to sing Joy Comes in the Morning and It Is Well. And I sang that song Sunday on If We Never Meet Again. And I texted Diana and I said, watch my video today and think about letting me replace that song in place of Joy Comes in the Morning. Diana said, great minds. I was thinking the same thing. Now, that scared me to think that your mind and my mind were on the same path. And that was just kind of scary to think about. But she said, I was thinking the same thing. The last time I sang that song in church was in Brother Ramsey's church in Fort Worth before he died. I can still see him sitting on the platform. And I sang, if we never meet again, this side of heaven. That's why I didn't say a word before I hit that music a while ago, so I could sing that song. But if we never meet again, this side of heaven, I'll meet you on that beautiful shore. Psalm 37, I'll just hit the highlights, and it talks about how we run the race. He says, fret not thyself because of evildoers. Don't worry about the government or the economy or the COVID or anything else. Don't worry about it. He says, and then he says, trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord. Get your eyes off of the world. Get them back on Jesus. Look forward to seeing George again. He's making up that great cloud of witnesses. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. That's tough today. That's going to be tough in the days ahead. That's going to be tough in the weeks ahead. You know, George is far better off, but he leaves a great hole, not only in Diana's life, but in Melissa's life and in these grandkids and everybody else. He leaves a hole there, but let God fill that hole. Rest in the Lord. Wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in the way. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. We're talking about running the race. And then he says, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. One more verse, over in a couple of verses in Philippians chapter 3. I'll leave you with this. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13, Paul said, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. We won't forget George. We won't forget the good times. Just remember, today's a celebration of his life. But forgetting all of those things which are behind, from this day we need to press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. We need to honor him in all things. And so I close and remind you that if you want to see George Abney ever again, you need to make sure you're born again Christian. It's a real simple thing to do. Realize, number one, I'm a sinner. Number two, Christ died for my sins. Number three, he rose on the third day for my justification. You pray a simple prayer and say, Lord, forgive me my sins. Come into my heart and save me for Jesus' sake. That's it. You say, well, that's too easy. Huh? He died on the cross to make that easy for us. And 43 years ago, George made that decision. Am I right, Diane? And I baptized him. So you think about that as we leave here today. And then just remember, we're surrounded with a great cloud of witnesses watching to see how we run the race. Keep that ever in the forefront of your mind every day. Lord, I know you're watching, but so is George. So is Jim and Sylvia. Now, that's a scary thought right there. So is Steve. So is David. So is Crystal. Everybody's, my dad died in 1987 at 67 years old. My mom died 2 years ago this month. She was 102. I have no idea what she was waiting on. But I know this, they make up that great cloud of witnesses. I want to make sure they watch how I run the race, and I want to be an honor to Almighty God. Father, thank you for meeting with us today. Thank you for your presence in the form of the Holy Spirit. I ask you, Father, to meet especially with Diana today and Melissa and the rest of the family. Fill this void over time and help us, Father, to go forth from here and run the race that is set before us. As we go to the cemetery, then as we have a time of fellowship today, we thank you. We honor you as we honor the life of George Abney. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
The way it all would end, the way it all would go, our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. It's my life, it's better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance.
How do I get through all night without you if I had to live without you? What kind of life would that be? Oh, now I need you in my arms, need you to hold. You're my world, my heart, my soul. If you ever leave, baby, you would take away everything good in my life.
would be no love in my life. There'd be no world left for me. And I, baby, I don't know what I would do. I'd be lost if I lost you. If you ever leave, baby, you would take away everything real in my life. And tell me now, how do I live without you? I want to know, how do I breathe without you? If you ever go, how do I ever, ever survive? How do I
I'm